holds four U.S. patents in semiconductor device technology. She ran for the Austin City Council in 2014. And her subsequent mission for verifiable, honest election results is continuing today. And I understand this week has been a very interesting week.
It's been a great week.
Yeah. So, welcome back, and we'll get you started here.
And then we'll get to really quickly the what's going on across the state of Texas for election integrity, because we have some huge, huge successes, guys, in the last year. It's been phenomenal. And I'll tell you, this system is one of them. They number a ballot, it's constitutional, and you have a paper ballot to go back to for a recount.
Yeah.
I mean, check, check, check. It's wonderful. Okay. So, I ran for the Austin City Council in 2014, and I knew I won my election. I knew I won. We had a very professional campaign. We had polling. We had paper, phone banking and block walking, all of it, professional campaign. Local Voice Solutions was one of our consultants, and knew I won the election. On election night, results came in. My opponent, 24-year-old, who had just moved in my district 2 weeks before the deadline, somehow beat me 2-1. There's no way. You know when you know something in your heart? What do? The election results were not what I was expecting. So do you step up and take personal responsibility, or do you step back and be a victim? We decided to step up, because someone has to deal with Texas elections that are not verifiable right now. Okay, that's the end of the story, end of the movie. So I got up, my PhD's in chemistry and physics, and I've got 4 patents on computer technology. I'm not the person you want to steal an election from with a computer. I'm the wrong one to do that for. And I'm pretty persistent. I grew up in Mansfield, Texas, south of Fort Worth, and my dad was an auctioneer at the stockyards, and he taught us to stand up for what's right. And so my husband and I decided to do that. And I tell you what, candidates, there are many in here. Voters want us to stand up. When we see something's wrong, and you know you won your election, you can't be 2.5 years later where I'm at right now if I didn't know I won my election. So when you know it, you owe it to your donors, to your volunteers, to the people that put you there. And I'll tell you one thing, our lawsuit right now that's in the Texas Supreme Court on this election integrity, we're $300,000. And the money will be there when we stand up, because voters want us to do it. They want us to do it. Let me take questions at the end.
It's just a statement.
Okay.
What you're saying about that is, if you can't stand up for yourself, how will I believe that you can stand up?
You got it. That's right. You got it. So voters want us to stand up, guys. They want us to do it. And the money will be there, because there's more people that want honest elections than those people that are stealing them. We're bigger numbers. So I got up the next morning and licked my wounds, and so I'm going to analyze some data, because I know how to use an Excel spreadsheet. And I know exactly how many precincts I have. I know who I talked to, all of it. And it was just a little city council race, 18 precincts, okay? So I went back and looked at every single precinct and the number of ballots that were cast, the number of voters that voted, very simple math, high school math, well, this is third grade math, and every single precinct was off. There were more ballots cast than there were voters in those precincts. My God, every single precinct was off. That's the fingerprint of a hack. It's not just a mistake. Election judges, how many can you be off by law? 1 or 2? You can't be 12 and 9 and 7. Something's really wrong. So that was the first thing that stuck out. The second thing is, there was a volunteer of mine at our election night, and he noticed a pattern. And he said, Laura, you know, you had a general election that had about 8 candidates. You know how city council's a lot of candidates, you know. 8 candidates, and then I moved forward to a runoff with myself, LP, and my opponent, Greg Kassar. So what does the volunteer know? He goes, Laura, you got the same percentage ratio in the runoff as you got in the general. I'm like, what does that mean? And he explained it to me. And I went back a couple months ago, and I thanked him for his announce, and he goes, I don't even know what you're talking about. I didn't say that to you. I said, yes, you did. You told me I had the same ratio in the general to the runoff. He goes, I didn't say that. I believe that was the hand of God. I'm going to tell you right now. He has no memory of saying it, and he doesn't even understand what it meant. But there was an emphasis there of what the pattern was. If there's a hack, there's a pattern. And what we found was shocking. Being an engineer, I looked at the top 80 precincts of where people voted, the 80-20 rule. You ever heard that? The 80-20 rule. So, there were 9 precincts where 80% of the voters voted. And I looked at my ratio to my opponent, that was going to be my opponent in the runoff. And I looked at my ratio relative to him, ignoring the 6 other candidates. And lo and behold, I got 35% of the vote. The same ratio I got in the runoff. And that's what he supposedly noticed and didn't understand it. However, I was told. And it was shocking because half the people had treated out. You can't keep the same numbers. And what we noticed was even more strong. Some precincts stayed exactly the same number, even though half the people had treated out. You don't do that. That doesn't make sense, those that know elections and those that run campaigns. So I had a statistician say, Laura, do this. Do some high school algebra. Plot on the x-axis what you got in the general and the y-axis what you got in the runoff and see if there's a trend. So I did that, and I'm going to show you real quick. And we did it for other candidates that were in runoffs too. So same kind of rule, general on the x, runoff on the y. This is high school algebra. And you see a scatter plot. This is a different race, another race, another race, and this one's mine. It's a straight line. How many math people in here? Yeah, r squared to 0.98. That's a program. And so I was an engineer, God, for 17 years. I shut a $1 billion factory down on data less correlated than that. All right? I knew what I was looking at. Most candidates might not know, but I'll tell you what I did. I got up, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I found this pattern. And again, this is that one-third pattern, that 35% pattern. I got up, went to bed, woke my husband up, and I said, I've just touched the devil. My lecture was hacked, and what are we going to do about it? And we're going to stand up, is what we said together, my husband and I. And here we are 2.5 years later. So you go back, and what do? You read the election code. Something's wrong. Let's figure it out. Let's do what's called a recount. And in Texas, like Chris said, you can do a manual recount, even on electronic voting. You can tell them to print what's called ballot images, and you do a hand recount, because something's just wrong here. We're going to fix it. Let's figure it out. I won that election. That 24-year-old didn't beat me 2-1. There's no way. So I started reading the election code, 200 chapters, and I read for one thing. What are the backup records for electronic voting? God bless the legislature, because they thought of this, and there's supposed to be all these backup records to prove. And guess what? We're not following law. Who knew? I was busy block walking and phone banking and kissing babies, and I didn't know how the electronic vote was going to be counted. I was hoping for the truth to come out. Hope didn't work on this one. So I went and read the election code, and basically it's powerful, the election code in Texas. The vote in an election, this is chapter 52, the election is by official ballot. I can speak English and I can read for comprehension. Pretty easy, right? Official ballot. What's an official ballot? Well, guess what? An official ballot has to be numbered. This is the Constitution of Texas, and it says elections by ballot, numbering, and fraud, and purity of elections, and all elections by the people, the vote shall be by ballot, and the legislature shall provide the numbering of tickets. Tickets in 1891, where the rule came into play, where the constitutional provision came into play, was a ballot. So ballots have to be numbered. And guys, I want you, when you vote in this November election, you look on that DRE and see if it's numbered. It is not. It doesn't meet the Constitution. Why do we number a ballot? Well, when you do a recount, if you have a little extra, some extra ballots, you have some missing, you have duplicates, you can catch them because things are serial numbered. And that came into play in the 1800s. Frauds have been going on a long time in Texas. And we know to number a ballot. But guess what? For the last 17 years, we have not numbered those electronic ballots. Can you believe that? Mm-hmm. all across the state, we've been violating the Constitution. Okay, so that's the first one. And then, the election code, the legislature adhered to what the Constitution required them to do, number ballots. Well, here it is, chapter 52.062. The ballots prepared by each authority, that's the county, responsible for having the official ballot prepared, shall be numbered consecutively beginning with one. Barbara, starting with one and go into the end so you can track and trace them. Check, 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 seems pretty simple, isn't it? So when I go do my recount, I expect to see a numbered ballot. Guess what? The county pulled me into the office when I said I want a recount, and they said, Dr. Presley, we can't give you a ballot image or a numbered ballot, but we can give you something else, and the Secretary of State says it's just fine. I'm going to show you that in a minute. All right, so it's got to be numbered, right? Well, look at this is Article 6, Section 4, Texas Election Code. Check, check, it's supposed to number. When you fill out an absentee, guess what? There's a number. It's a serial number, very unique, just like Barbara said. Unique number, it's not duplicated. When we recounted these guys, the official ballots, paper, absentee, it was an exact tie, 240 to 240. Oh, I was all excited. It's not 2-1. So, let me skip through this in just a minute. This is the recount code that says you can print images of the ballots to do the manual recount. So it's all in the election law. So we show up to Travis County, we can't give you a ballot image for a manual recount. We can give you what something's called a cast vote record. And this is what's provided across the state of Texas for electronic voting. And it looks like this. They printed 4,000 of these. This is from a PDF document. The pages are not numbered. Anybody use Adobe Acrobat? You know, you can move pages in and out. Yeah. Where the heck did this thing come from? I asked the county and they wouldn't tell me. But guess what? It's not numbered. No telling where these came from.
Now they could put a serial number in Adobe.
You certainly could. Computers are good at numbering. They're real good at it, right? So this is not even a ballot image. You know, there's no boxes. You know, I was in the election, my name's not on it. So this is not an image of a ballot, it's not a ballot, it's not even an image file. It's a data structure printed one per page from an Excel spreadsheet. Okay, and you can change those easy. It's easy to go change an Excel spreadsheet numbers, okay? So guess what? Not a constitutional ballot. So I said, stop the presses, we're gonna file a lawsuit. You're not following the law, Travis County. And by the way, the paper ballots are the only legal ballots. They're tied, there's no victor. We need a new election. With a paper system, that meets the Constitution. And so we filed the first lawsuit in the state. The candidates have known this has been an issue for 10, 15 years, guys. And no one's done anything about it. We didn't know what to do. And now we're where we are. Okay, there's another record that has to be there. So you gotta have a ballot image with number. We don't have that. No county in the state has that, guys. None, zero. Can't just scratch that off. The second backup record, election judges, is the tape. The results tape, and that's required by law. It's chapter 66. It says envelopes number one, judges. You're an election judge. You're doing a lot of big responsible work. You have to have the original election returns and the tally list, and you return that to the county. There you go. And it's actually a Class B misdemeanor if you don't do it, judges, because it's big time. This is what a tally tape looks like. All the results for each candidate, this was a tape back from Travis County, Dewhurst and Cruz when they were running, results of each candidate. And what is that for? That's in case there's something happening to the memory card that goes to the county. You now have a tape, judges, that you sign. You authenticate it in case something happens. It's a backup paper record. Well, in Travis County, they told the judges don't print the tape for my election. Well, there's no ballot image, and now there's no tape. How convenient. Now you can steal an election blind. If you don't have the backup records, you can do what the heck you want. Right? Simple. I've had engineers work for me that could do this with their hands tied behind their back. This is Windows 2000 software.
Okay.
So they told them, don't print the tally. But why did Travis County not print the tally? Well, because they're a county-wide polling. location. It takes too long to print it. Don't worry, don't print it. You want to get home. So they got a waiver to law. Now let that sink in. A waiver to law by a bureaucrat in the Secretary of State's office. And this is the letter. And it says, rather than printing the complete tally tape, judges, just print what's called an access code report, which is just a number of people that showed up. That's not a return. Okay? And don't worry, because in recounts, valid images remain on the tools until you ask. They'll say it all day long, but until you ask for it, they can't give it to you.
Just trust them.
Just trust and hack away. All right. So, we had the county clerk of Travis County on the witness stand, and my lawyer's really good. He goes, why didn't you follow law? She says, well, that's not the final law. And my lawyer said, what's the final law?
The Travis County one.
So, we asked her, yeah. So, that's basically what she said. We asked her, do you think the Secretary of State can tell you not to follow state law?
Yeah.
I know they can. So we got the county clerk on the witness stand with a transcript, says, I don't have to follow law because Secretary of State told me I don't have to. Let that one sink in too, guys. That's shocking.
I robbed the bank.
She takes
the
an oath
State
to uphold the Constitution of the state of Texas. And she's just saying, I don't have to do it because someone else told me so. So Keith Ingram, Director of Elections, bureaucrat, is given advice to counties not to follow law. It's not good. So what's the third record? There's a third record of elections. It's called the audit log tape. Anybody here that does computers know that it's an audit log. It's a timeline stamp of every activity that happens on a computer. Well, in the state of Texas, it's a big long printout. You have the time, date, stamp of everything that happens. So in our lawsuit, we said, let's get the audit log and see what it says about my election. So we got it. And remember, what happens, this is Hardinger Civic Equipment in Travis County, but this is similar for everybody. You vote on the machine, the electronic vote goes on a memory card. And in this case, it's going to be a thumb drive. Those memory cards go where? They go down to the main office at the county, and they start getting tabulated. And most of the time, no one's down there. Everybody's at the precinct being poll watchers. Well, who's watching the store at the county? Almost nobody. And in my case, no one was watching. And we got the log and we were shocked. What we found was amazing. There were corrupt mobile ballot boxes being inputted into the main computer over and over. Especially was the first card in, because if you want to hack an election, you want to set up the program, for all the cards coming in after, and then you can back write them. Wow. So we noticed the first card that was put in on election night was number 603. We got the audit log of 603 and another set of computers that program those memory cards. Card 603, very interesting, was logged in on 11/21 and logged out 10 days later. Where was that card for 10 days? Was it logged in the computer, sitting there the whole time for 10 days? Did it get pulled out, taken away? Who knows where it was for 10 days? These memory cards are like ballot boxes. Do you want a ballot box to be missing for 10 days?
No.
Not a good idea. Then again, the same card, number 603. 12/1, logged out, 12/10, 9 days. 19 days, we don't know where that card went. And that was the first correct card in. We said, oh my gosh, we want to get to that card. Judge, we want to get to that card. Because it looks like there's an issue with it. There's a security issue. The county did a discovery control plan. The judge said, you can't get to the card. You can't get to it. It's proprietary. You can't get to it, Dr. Presley. And by the way, you have a frivolous lawsuit. We're going to throw you out of court with a no evidence summary judgment. Really?
Because you couldn't get the evidence.
Well, you couldn't get it, but we had evidence. We had evidence of no numbering. We had evidence, 12,000 pages. And then we were sanctioned for a frivolous lawsuit at $100,000 for bringing this lawsuit. And it was said in the courtroom, when it's sanctioned so high that no candidate ever brings this case like this ever again in the state of Texas. And by the way, Dr. Presley, We'll remove the sanctions if you don't appeal. Do we step up or do we step back? And we stepped up. We said, we're going to appeal. We got slapped with over 100K in sanctions. So we're appealing. The third court upheld the judge's ruling. We are now in the Texas Supreme Court. And they have moved us to the next level. We did our petition for review. They demanded a response from our opponent. And now they've demanded full briefing. And it's just a miracle. It's an absolute miracle. And I'll show you kind of the legal arguments in a second. That's where we're at. So it's amazing. And we're 300,000 later. And we've raised 240,000 around the state. So I want to pass this around. This lawsuit is not about Travis County and Austin elections anymore. This is about us. We have to have honest and verifiable elections. And I'm going to ask you for your financial help. If you'll help me, then your favorite candidates won't have to do this later. Because this is important. And if we don't have honest and fair elections, guys, what do we have in this state? We have a representative form of government, and if we don't have honest elections, then our representatives know we don't matter. You ever had someone tell, you know, behave as if the voter doesn't matter? Maybe they know we don't. Okay, I'm going to pass these out. There's envelopes if you want to consider a donation, and give me your email address, and have envelope there if you want to. I want you to consider, we're at 300,000. We need 10 more thousand to finish the case in the Supreme Court. Okay, I'm going to skip through this. I want to get to what the updates are. All right, one thing I want to give a heads up. Mr. Keith Ingram, who's giving waivers to law and who says we don't have to have a number on the ballot, he's doing a lot of stuff around the state. He's actually dismantling what I call election integrity. Back last in the primaries, in March 2016, he sent out a waiver letter that told the counties, don't worry, don't do the post-election audit. The post-election audit is for those paper absentee ballots, run it through the machine, and you got to do a recount, manual recount of those, about 3 precincts or 3% of the precincts. And he sent an email out to all the counties, 254 counties in Texas, said, don't worry, don't do it. I'm going to waive that. So where's that audit now? Now we don't have an audit for electronic. Now we don't have an audit for the paper. This is shocking. And there was one race that this impacted, Byron Cook. Uh-huh. Remember Byron Cook in Hill County? They kept putting the ballots in over and over. He double counted a lot of ballots. This audit would have caught it, and he would not have won. Mr. Ingram waived that audit for every county in the state. So I want to challenge you out tomorrow. I want you to call the election administrator, call Bruce, and say, are you going to do your post-election audit for the November election? And are you going to do it for the primary? Because the answer better be yes. Voters can put pressure, and commissioner's court can hold them accountable to doing their audit and ignore Mr. Ingram's little waivers. We want verifiable elections in the state. And it's up to us to take back our elections.
Hey, Laura, I have a question. Never mind, I'll say this.
Okay. So let's skip through. We'll skip through this. There's a lot here.
Does Mr. Ingram tell you what authority he has to somehow, some way ignore the state law? And what does the appointed Secretary of State say?
It's a great question. There's a statute that says the Secretary of State can interpret the election code. It's their job to interpret and apply it. And he thinks he can interpret the way he's interpreting it. And so that's why we're in the Supreme Court. We want the court to give us guidance on the interpretation of the Constitution. It says we got a number. That's the little detail there. Yeah. And the Secretary of State is staying out of it because he's the elections director. Yes?
I thought he worked for the Secretary of State.
He does. He does. That's right. You got it. That's right.
So he's not an elected judge.
He's a bureaucrat. He's a bureaucrat. He's a lawyer. He's a lawyer who's interpreting the Constitution differently the way I'm interpreting it, and the rest of the state interprets it.
He has a background. It's a nice word.
He's got an ego. You know Keith.
I know Keith.
Yes, he's...
I've fought him a couple of times, and I've won.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a lot of things he's done to kind of dismantle different laws. Actually, there's something very recent in August, a couple months ago, he tried to get rid of the audit log. The audit log's kind of important, isn't it? Yeah, it's kind of important. Tells you what's going on. So he tried to put through an administrative rule change to redact and remove the audit log, and we threw a fit. We've got a big network around the state now. I've given 200 presentations in the last 2.5 years across the state. Hold it. I'm sorry. I know we... Okay, thank you. Please hold it. Okay. So we've got a huge network. We had hundreds of emails that were sent. It just takes 25 to get a public hearing on an administrative rule change. We got the public hearing, and they committed to leaving the current administrative code alone and keep the audit log. He has to be watched every moment, and I'm doing it. We cannot leave anything to chance right now with Mr. Ingram where he's at. Okay? And we have asked him to be removed by the governor over and over and over, and he's still there. And so we are the watchdogs. We are. Okay, Mr. Ingram's political history, I want to go through this real quick. He was a lawyer in Austin. Because he's a state employee, we got his employee file through a public information request. He was a lawyer in Austin for 10 years. He represented doctors and pharmaceutical companies in malpractice lawsuits. He moved to Little Rock, Arkansas in 2006 and worked there for about a year for a guy named Gordon Wilborn in Little Rock. This is Gordon Wilborn. He now is at the Kutok Rock Law Firm. Gordon Wilborn is a former, where's Mr. Wilborn? Right here. Former partner of Hillary Clinton at the Rose Law Firm. Oh, you have Hillary, this is old letterhead we found. Gordon Wilborn, this guy, Keith Ingram supervisor. You got Hillary, you got Webster Hubble, Vince Foster, the whole slew of them. Mr. Ingram has a history with the Clintons. And he's in charge of our elections in Texas. It's a problem, I think. He comes back to Austin and is appointed by Rick Perry into the appointments office and then goes to work as the most powerful man in the state for elections. And he's been dismantling our elections ever since, giving waivers to law, ignoring the Constitution, and trying to get rid of audit logs. And we're not putting up with it. It's our state. We love Texas. I love Texas. This is not going to happen. Okay, so we filed our case in the Supreme Court, and I'm doing it pro se. I have a couple of lawyers supporting me, helping me. I do the briefs, and they give us a cut rate doing that. And so we have three questions to the court. We're saying, do you have to have a numbered ballot for electronic voting? Does the Constitution apply to all ballots? That's the first question. The second, can the Secretary of State suspend mandatory election laws where there's an actual criminal penalty if you don't do them? There's two kinds of laws in Texas, mandatory and directory. Mandatory is when you have a criminal penalty. That's kind of important, you know? Those are the important ones. And also, was this a frivolous case? And can we please get rid of the Hunter Kane sanctions? Because there's no other candidate in the state of Texas in the last 150 years that's ever been sanctioned for an election contest ever in Texas. I'm the first. Shocking. Yeah, I guess it's good. Okay, so the first question, the number. We provide the evidence to the court. Constitution says you got a number. Election code says you have to number. Paper ballot absentees have a number. But guess what? Electronic does not. We think electronic and paper ballots ought to be legally equivalent under the law. Pretty simple. And guess what? We got an email from Partner Civic that says we don't number ballots because actually Secretary of State says we don't need to.
Oh, man.
Yeah, no kidding. That's really good. And guess what? There's tons of case law that says ballots have to be numbered from the 1800s all the way to 2011. So we've even have case law on our side. We presented that. So the second issue about the the tapes, the backup records. Here's the law. You got to have returns, and it's a misdemeanor if you don't. We provided for evidence the letter from Keith Ingram, Director of Elections, under the Secretary of State seal. They don't think we need them. There's actually case law that says you have to have election returns in Texas from the precinct, and that goes back to 1911. We even have case law on that. Very strong. The second, is this a frivolous case? Y'all can answer that yourself. The court, I think, is going to overturn that. The good thing that's happened is the Attorney General's office wrote an amicus brief supporting our case, supporting the numbering, because the AG's office actually certifies this equipment. And they're like, Dr. Presley's got an interesting point about the numbers. We should have those numbers. And in the conclusion of their amicus, where they're supporting in support of the petitioner, which is us, they said, the question of whether unnumbered ballots cast using DRE machines may lawfully be considered in a manual recount impacts what voting machines may be approved in Texas and is worthy of the court's review. So the AG says, I need some help, Supreme Court. We want this case heard. We need your guidance. So that's the status of where we are. We're really proud. It's been a long road, and we need to finish it. We're almost there.
Had your petition been granted, or you just got
briefing? Not granted. We just got full briefing. So, and that is the next 6 months, 6 to 9 months stage. Because you do 3 briefs, about 2 months each, about 6 months, and then they'll make a decision to hear or not hear. Yeah. But this is really great. This is not frivolous. They don't just grant briefing on a frivolous case. I feel confident they're going to remove the sanctions at minimum. And they've already pretty much ruled out it's not moved, even though the term is over. Because it's going to happen again. Okay, so let's talk about what's going on in Texas, big picture with voting. There is a county, Hays County, which is south of Austin. Guess what? When you were just asking about those memory cards, they actually lost a memory card. They had 1,800 ballots on it. Oh, oops. Oops. They didn't know what they did with it. They tabulated the November election without those 1,800 people. The only reason they found out was there was an election contest that said, uh-oh, there's some ballots missing. Where are they? So the county had to cough up the card. Who knows how many times this has happened, but no one caught it. So we had the county says, we don't know who these 1,800 people are. They sign in, don't they, Judge? So they do know, so that was not truthful from the county's own yapping, all right? So we got the list through a public information request, and we had a meeting, and we printed all 1,800 names in alphabetical order, and we invited the 1,800 people, and they showed up, and they were actually physically sick at their stomach. When they looked and saw, their vote was not counted. I want you to look at these faces. Look at them. A lot of emotion. And guess what? The county judge, his vote didn't count. One of the commissioners didn't count. Their names were on the list because they showed up to early vote, and that one was the one lost. Imagine. It's so much easier to lose a card. Put it in your pocket. Where'd it go? This is harder. When there's 1,800 ballots, a big old box. Where'd that? It's under someone's desk. Where'd it go? Huge issue. Hays County is looking and pressing for a paper ballot option because they're sick and tired of this. Okay? Our Republican Party platform, anybody here with delegates to the platform? Okay, we approved, Mr. SREC, good job. We approved a platform with some key election issues. We want all the tapes printed for all the counties. Secretary of State, this is a Republican Party platform now. Oops. Okay, there we go. The next one, we support all integrity of elections, including optional use of paper. That was never in the platform before. We like a paper backup, and actually countywide has a heightened potential for fraud because counties aren't printing the tapes. Big issues. So that's a big plus. Denton County just went to a paper backup system. It's a HART system, not this one. But that's really good. They're the largest county in Texas that's converted from electronic to a paper system.
Wow.
Okay, big news. We've got now the ESNS system has a number. It takes a real ballot image that can be recounted, and you verify it before it goes in. We haven't had that, guys, in 17 years. It's amazing where we're at right now. It's amazing. Ken Paxton's office, another plus for them, just put out an opinion yesterday that said these systems can be used in countywide polling. That's huge. Thank God for Ken Paxton. Thank God. A lot of successes. So I want to kind of just roll through these. The platform, Plank 59, is much stronger for election integrity. We want to protect it. There's going to be a big push this next convention to gut that. You delegates, no way. Okay? We want to keep our election integrity. Mail-in ballot security has happened because of Aaron Harris and the special session, so God bless them. We retain our election laws and the administrative code, even though Mr. Ingram's trying to get rid of them. We held him speak to the fire. The AG has validated hybrid systems with countywide. The AG has raised the issue of ballot numbering to the Supreme Court. Our election integrity case is moving forward, and Texans are motivated and care. That's right.
Yeah.
So yes.
What do we need next? What do we need?
$60,000.
Oh, yeah. We want to purchase paper backup systems across the state. Okay? We want honest and fair elections. As a candidate, I'd much rather handle paper fraud than electronic. How many people does it take to change 100,000 paper ballots? Yeah. A lot of people. And then I'll tell them. They're like, yeah, talk, right? How many people does it take to...
One.
Corrupt 100,000 ballots. One or two people.
Right?
I'd much rather handle the paper fraud. Much rather. Okay? We want to assign poll watchers at the main computers. Barbara Harless was at the main computer in November in Collin County.
In Dallas.
Mm-hmm. And Kristen and Sammy were at in Dallas. A lot of shenanigans went on. And you know what? They didn't know how to handle it. People usually at the precinct. Well, you're at the main computer, and that's where the dirty business is going on. That's where the rubber meets the road. All the cards come to you. It's really simple there to hack that. Especially when you let corrupt cards go in and out. All right. And we've seen corruption errors in Houston. Travis sees them every election. Llano County, Vernon County. We've seen them all over Texas, not just in Travis. Call your election administrator, make sure they're going to adhere to the post-election audit in November. Please call them tomorrow. I'll help educate poll watchers, candidates, and voters on election integrity issues. I'll help any candidate. Whatever you need from me, I'm here to help. And we've got to educate and hold our state reps and state senators accountable to plank number 59, and we have to really protect it. Take back our elections county by county. That's where we're at, guys. I think we're in a great position in Texas, better than we've ever been in over 17 years. So thank y'all there's so many in here who have helped us with donations, and I'm so grateful for it. Thank y'all. Thanks.
Chris's system, does it comply with everything you had problems with?
Yes, it does.
Yes.
It does. It's got a number ballot. It's a paper backup. It keeps a ballot image. Yes. Yes.
Little shout out to Chris.
Yes, good job. Yes, sir.
One thing we put in, you know, being chair of the ballot board, I can make suggestions and do things. And based on what Aaron Harris went through in Tarrant County, I asked this Bruce Sherwood, and he approved it. So in the presidential election, every mail ballot that had a witness on it went to me directly. So I had a whole stack, probably 300 of them.
Wow.
And I purposely looked through to see if I had people multiple witnessing on ballots. Well, we found one set where there was multiple witnessing, which you really can't do, but the voter's signs in the correct place everywhere. The witness was just an extra signature, so we counted those two. But we put that procedure in just to be on the safe side now, because somebody could witness 10, 15, 30 ballots,
right.
And that's where your fraud is in mail ballots.
That's right.
Yeah.
So one extra precaution.
Great job. Great job. Good job. Yes, sir.
Laura, state rep contacted me a couple weeks ago with concerns about this particular ESNS machine. And we didn't have time to go into the technical details, but they claimed that there is means by which the results of the machine can somehow be manipulated in Democratic strongholds, right? I mean, it could be manipulated anyway, but it would be in Democratic strongholds. Have you heard any objections to this machine's or this next generation machine, not just from ESNS, that you know, specific concerns about?
Yeah, I think, you know, guys, we're going to have our human brethren are not all honest. Isn't that a simple statement?
No.
It's a big issue. And so we have to be diligent as candidates and be aware. We've got to prevent our election from being stolen, guys. We just do. And so, like I said before, I would much rather deal with paper fraud than electronic any day of the week, because how's paper fraud going to happen? You're going to stuff it. Well, you've got a number now. Okay? And I'll tell you another thing. When you do a recount, if you're number 452 and you know you voted for Donald Trump, and that ballot 452 in the recount doesn't have Donald Trump as chosen, you got proof of fraud. Someone's going to jail.
In that particular case, that's one word against another. That's why earlier I asked about the voter being able to have a copy of the ballot. If the voter doesn't have a copy of the ballot, then it's he said, she said.
You can write it down. You can write your number down.
You can take a picture of it, right? You take a picture of the ballot.
You're not supposed to take a picture of a ballot, but people do. Okay, you're not supposed to do it. It's a felony. It's a felony. We've tried to get that changed. Okay, we're working on getting that changed. But you can record your ballot. And especially if you're voting for yourself or whatever, when you do a recount, you get copies of those ballots, and you can. Someone's going to jail, and you send one person to jail, it ain't ever happening again for a long time. Okay, because someone's not going to want to go to jail for somebody else. Okay.
So the companies the competing companies all have their own lobbyists, and they're all trashing each other in Austin.
Yes. Of course.
They are. They are. But if you have a numbered ballot, you have just jumped over so much. And as a candidate, you have to be responsible. You got to have some money in the bank for a recount in case something happens. Or be old enough to have good credit. Yeah. I got 0% interest on my credit cards right now, so that's really good. Yeah. Any other questions?
Have you used Joseph Stalin's quote in your briefs?
No, but it's true. It's true.
I'm surprised we didn't sneak in on your briefs.
I know. But I'm here to help. Guys, I've helped candidates, congressional candidates, national candidates, city council candidates, other candidates. I'm here to help, guys. What we've walked through, you know, I have a friend in Houston that tells me, you know, Laura, when opportunity knocks, it's wearing overalls and looks like work. You know, this was a huge opportunity. I'm not happy about it, but I'm not running again until this gets addressed. Because I know I won.
What's your remedy in the court other than getting rid of the sanctions, though?
Pardon? What's the remedy for the
remedy
court? Good question. It is giving the Secretary of State guidance on the numbering and on the mandatory laws that they have to print the tape, they've got to have it authenticated, and remove the sanctions.
That's why it's not moved.
And we're not, yeah, and we're not asking for a lot. We're asking for the state to have honest elections and give the Secretary of State some guidance. We've been very kind about that, actually. Yeah.
So you went through the election contest, or did you just lose on the summary judgment?
We lost on the summary judgment.
And so you're appealing that, and obviously it was affirmed by the Third Court of Appeals in Austin, but didn't you not plead for a new election, or at least to reinstate the election contest so you can, because the only way to get rid of a fraudulent vote is through an election contest.
That's right.
I've done two of them.
That's right.
My comment to you is they're brutal.
They are.
Plus you have to prove the fraud in your your race, not just in anybody else's race. And one question I've always had, so you didn't plead for that, though. Is that part of your prayer, or is that part of you didn't want that, is to make
the term's already over. The term's over.
Right.
It's been such a long process here. The term is over, and so we're done with that. We just want them to opine on what the law is, give guidance, because it's going to happen again, and change the sanctions.
Your race was nonpartisan, wasn't it?
It's a city council's
right.
Nonpartisan. Yeah.
Supposedly.
Yeah. I'm a conservative Christian, you know, and my opponent was a proclaimed atheist, which is that's a good, you know, competition. But yeah, the summary judgment, you know, was very disappointing. You know, what we said was those 4,000 ballots that had no number, you can't count those. Those are illegal ballots or unconstitutional ballots. They have to be thrown out. And the only ballots that remain are the paper which are tied.
Right.
So we didn't even have to prove fraud. We jettisoned that. We just said, we're not going to go there. We're there. It's like a traditional election contest where everything's tied up. You just need a new election with a system that's legal. And we wanted there's going to be another election, small.
Were there any other candidates or in the on the ballot in your race that had this problem?
Yes. There were a couple other candidates that had a straight line too, and they just didn't have the bandwidth to do it. So it wasn't just me that had an issue. There were others, and when you don't have the backup records, fraud can just waltz across Texas, guys.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever consider going to federal court? Because, you know, on every 2 years, there's obviously a congressional race on the ballot, whether you have a senatorial race or even a presidential race. And my question is, if there's a congressional race, that could invoke federal jurisdiction.
And there was no federal jurisdiction because it was a city council runoff.
So you didn't have a federal.
There was not.
Because that obviously. Okay.
Yeah, so we're stuck in state.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've been down that path twice, and that's why I was kind of curious.
That's a good question. Yeah.
Because I don't know how many times there's a new election that's actually granted.
It's rare.
It's extremely rare.
It's rare. And this was a unique case. This is a case of first impression in this form, because no one's ever brought in Texas electoral voting fraud, ever. This was the first case, and it was unique. It's just incredible that the paper ballots were exactly tied. I mean, then it puts it very similar to a regular, typical election contest. We don't know where those ballots came from. They were in that PDF. And actually, I asked them to show me where they came from. They refused. But that's even in the petition.
Statistically, that's pretty weird.
It is weird, isn't it?
It's almost impossible.
Yes, ma'am.
And you brought up the federal aspect of this. Could you explain to everyone here about Ingram's role and the two, he's a witness and the other witness against you in the trial that are serving on the Election Assistance Commission?
So help me understand that question.
Okay. The election.
Because Keith was never on the witness stand.
Well, he wasn't, but she was.
The clerk
was,
yeah.
Okay. There's a nationwide commission in Washington, D.C., where every state sends two representatives.
Yeah, that's right.
And so Keith Ingram and the
Dana DeMavoie, the clerk.
The clerk who testified against her are on this commission. And this commission meets.
And Obama appoints them.
Yes, he appointed a commissioner. At the time this happened, there was no commissioner. It was Bacon at that time. And so they didn't meet. But they do meet now, and they come up with national policy on elections. And so my question, you couldn't answer this, but what are they telling all their colleagues in all these other states of what's permissible, that they can wave a wand and they can change the law?
Yes.
Are they telling all the other states to do that?
Well, I'll say our state has some of the most strict laws, so they're up a creek, because they have to either waive them and ignore them. Other states don't have numbering. So we think that once Texas gets this ruling, I feel confident we're going to prevail in this, because it's just English, guys. A lot of states are going to follow and look at this as being real election integrity. And we've got the Election Assistance Commission members watching our case.
Oh, and
we
Senator Cruz is on the Oversight Committee over the EAC. So,
good.
So we have a watching. Yes, sir.
In the forensics, if you will, of the ballot fraud, right? You found that positive correlation, right?
Right, the straight line, right. Yeah.
Is there any additional information from data analysis that would point to the source? Like, was this mechanically done through a program alteration? Where it was done. In other words, you and I both know as engineers that you can write code and you can propagate it. And other people pointed out this evening that through malware you can do a lot of stuff, a lot of leverage, let's put it that way, okay? Was there enough forensic evidence to point to anything more specific other than something happened someplace along the line?
Yeah, we couldn't get to the car. They made sure we couldn't get to it. And when we were asking for it, that's when the summary judgment happened. Yeah, I mean, it was like, boom, like, you can take 5 minutes in the transcript. That's when it happened. Right. All I know is 19 days, I don't know where that car was. I don't know where it was for 19 days. Yeah. Yeah, so what I think happens is they take the card out, they program it, they bring it back in, and the guy putting the cards in is told just keep moving. Because you have an error. It says corruption. And you can pull that card out and not continue, but they push the button yes to continue to load it.
Yeah, but the corruption indicator is pretty sloppy, right? I mean, let's say it's a CRC or something, whatever, right? If you know what you're doing, it's not going to come up corrupted, right? I mean, I'm surprised
God
they made
the software engineers. They actually used a good word, right?
Yeah, yeah, right.
Well, that was the other thing that worried me about when Keith wanted to remove the audit logs. Those were some of the errors he wanted to take out. No, we want those. We want more backup workers. We want more audibility, verifiability. We don't want less. Yeah. So we couldn't get to the car. We had a computer science expert, a PhD, who was ready to analyze it. But we couldn't get it. Yeah. Yes, ma'am?
I understood you to say that the governor will not remove this person?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. We've asked over and over and over for 2 years.
And his reason has been?
Good question. We had a woman from a Tea Party in Cherokee County, Josie Schoolcraft. I don't know if anybody knows her. She was just livid. So she called the governor's office and quote unquote, the governor's staff told her, we can't get rid of Keith Ingram because Rick Perry hired him. I'm just, quote unquote. Whatever that means, we're not sure, but he's still there. And he's still trying to waive stuff, and he's still giving waivers, he's still giving, you know, trying to get rid of audit logs. Just as of 3 weeks ago, Chris, something about the audit log thing? 3 weeks ago. But we're watching. We're taking back our elections. You know what? I'm a woman of faith, and the Lord will help us if we stand up. All he wants us to do is stand up. Say no. We're watching. You can't do this. We have to stand. And I'm grateful that this is this opportunity. It looks like work and it's wearing overalls. But thank y'all for being there because it's a coalition, guys. We've built a coalition around the state of thousands of people and thousands of y'all because y'all are the active ones and we're the ones that matter. We're it. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Their machine tonight. The competitor declined the invitation, but we're happy to have Chris here. A couple of months ago, actually now, A few of us went up to the county and we saw the demo in action at Collin County, and we're very impressed with it. So we thought that would be a great thing for all the citizens to be aware of. This county, and Cheryl, the decision will be made in the next year?
We'll do an RFP probably sometime in summer 2018, and then it'll probably take another 6 to 8 months before we determine that it would then be so probably either late 2018 or early 2019.
Right. So we will be getting new voting machines. That's a fact. And
we have to.
Yeah. And I know that Bruce had mentioned at elections that they wanted to have the machines up and running at an election before the next presidential election. They didn't want to test it out or have the first, you know, implementation of that machine on a presidential race. So it'll be coming up pretty quick. But just a little, this is the first time I'm meeting Chris, but I want to tell you something about him. I talked to him a few times on the phone. And our meeting was normally scheduled on Thursday. We moved it to Wednesday. But when we scheduled on Thursday, and I called Chris if he'd be willing to demonstrate the machine, and he said, sure. And then I called him back and I said, well, how about Wednesday? And then he told me, he said, that would work better because I was willing to do the demo, but he had an appointment Friday morning in, what, Brownsville?
Brownsville, yeah.
And he would have been driving all night. So, well, I thank you for being willing to do that, and we're glad that we could accommodate you a little bit better on Wednesday. So, hopefully, we'll make this interactive.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
Okay, and tell me to...
Well, thanks everybody for having me out. This is the shortest distance I've ever driven for a demonstration. I live in Collin County, or over in Prosper, so not too far away. Let me find my slideshow here real quick.
It's already up there.
All right. First of all, I'm going to give you a little bit of information on the company. Our corporate office is based out of Omaha, Nebraska. And we have satellite offices throughout the nation, depending on where the pockets of the most business are. We have a lot of business in Texas, so we have our Texas service and support office down the road in Plano, off of Park Central Parkway. So that's where I work. I live in Prosper. I'm going to run through the company portion pretty quickly, and then I'm going to kind of talk through some of the products, how we kind of came to developing this product. And then I'm going to go through a demonstration, but I'm going to try to get to that pretty quickly because the last couple of days I did, there was about an hour and a half of questions afterwards, so I want to make sure everybody's got enough time to go through questions. So quickly about the company, nationwide, this is kind of how we, what our customer base looks like. We're in 43 states. There's a lot of states where the decision on buying tabulation systems done at the state level, so we're in a lot of statewide systems. We got over 400 employees, and about 100 million of the registered voters will vote on one of our systems in a federal election. So to get through the company part quickly, we have a video that we usually show people. I'm going to...
Election Systems and Software, we are proud of what we do and who we do work for. We are far from an ordinary company. Our foundation is elections, the bedrock of democracy, formed during our country's earliest chapters.
We do get to support democracy and keep such a historical part of our country intact.
What we do here affects the whole nation. What we do here, we have an impact.
Our employees are driven by the mission to promote better elections every day.
It is neat to be part of that process and you know that you're contributing not only to the experience of that voter, but to the future of the country as well.
We just helped a military and overseas ballots out for the general election. What an amazing thing it is that we get to help military personnel vote.
I feel proud to say I support democracy, and as an employee of ESNS, I get to see firsthand how important those elections are.
At ES&S, our employees are part of something bigger than themselves.
It's a great company, full of can-do people, and this is a great environment for that.
It's nice. It's like, this is my home. It's a good family that I come to.
Our mission is simple.
Better elections every day.
Better elections every day.
Better elections every day.
This mission is backed by a set of core values, values which define who we are and reflect what is truly important.
Make a difference.
Make a difference.
Build trust and respect.
Build trust and respect. Work hard. Work hard.
Have fun.
Have fun.
Talk straight.
Talk straight.
And dream big.
Dream big.
And dream big.
So that's our company in a nutshell. So several years ago, everybody bought voting equipment nationwide. And then going back maybe 3, 4, 5 years ago, we started trying to figure out what the future of voting was going to look like. Everybody's equipment was aging, and we knew it was time to start thinking about replacing it. So we were trying to figure out which direction was the market leaning as far as voting systems go. Was it leaning DRE? Was it leaning paper? We polled the industry, we tried to figure it out. The one thing that we could see consistently was that since HAVA, electronic voting started diminishing a little bit. And over time, I think at the time HAVA started, there were 37 states that had certified systems that had no paper trail certified in them. And today I think we're down to 5 or 6. Virginia a couple weeks ago just decertified electronic voting there. So the trend's been going down. So, with that, what we tried to take into account when we were developing a new system was the election management staff, the people, for example, here in Collin County, Bruce Sherbert's staff. What did they go through? Because the current systems today take too much staff and time to set them up, test them, get them, deploy them on election day. There's just a lot of components to them, a lot of steps to test them, get them ready for the election. They're getting harder to maintain. Parts are getting harder to find for all these systems. Supply chains are starting to run out in a lot of these systems to get parts for.
Thank you.
And you know, last but not least, the current systems are starting to get a lot of negative feedback. Even some of the paper systems out there, because they're getting so old, they're not reading ballots as accurately as they used to, and because of the technology that they're using to read the ballots, just it's not up to date. The next phase we were trying to look at was poll workers. We wanted to make life easy on the election staff, but we also wanted to make it easier on the poll workers. How many in here are poll workers or have been? It's tough getting into the polling location at 6 a.m, getting the poll set up and ready for the first voter to be checked in, especially if there's 15 people standing in line waiting on you, right? So, we wanted to make it a lot easier for them to set up. We had one jurisdiction show us their checklist, and I'm not gonna tell you what vendor it was, but it was 37 pages long, their checklist to set up their polling location. But what we try to do is put it on 1 or 2 pages. So after you go through after you see the demonstration, you'll see how it's a lot easier for a poll worker to set up. The other thing, current systems today have too many points of failure or points of mistakes being made, and it'll be easier when I walk through it to kind of point out where those areas are. In a lot of states here, or a lot of counties here in the state, the county staff actually goes out and set up the polling locations for the poll workers just because they're so difficult. I know here in Collin County, Bruce's staff actually goes and sets up all the polling locations. Voters, the last one, we wanted to make it easier on the voters. For the voters, you know, voters are like, where did my vote go if they're voting electronically? Because when they get cast ballot, there's nothing physical to take to a ballot box or a tabulator and drop it down. And we have DRE machines too, so we hear the same feedback. Voter intent, this is a big one. This is really what came out of the Florida 2000 election with voter intent. Paper ballot systems have this issue quite a bit because the machines or the voters, they fill in an oval for one candidate, and then decide they don't want to vote for that candidate, so they X him out and fill in the other oval. Well, two different ballot boards may look at that differently. One may look at it as an emphasis vote for the one that's got the X in it, and then another ballot board may say, no, you're crossing that selection out, voting for the other person. So voter intent's a big deal. And you don't get that with electronic voting because the machine won't let you, you know, halfway mark someone. And then voter confidence is a big one. So what we came up with was a system that you can interact with just like a DRE. You know, it would eliminate the voter intent. A system that would record your selections to paper and not computer memory. And there's a lot of benefits to that, by the way, and I'll point them out as I go through the demonstration. A system that would allow voters to hold their ballot in hand before it's tabulated, so they could actually have that last chance to review their selections on a piece of paper before they tabulate it, either on a machine or drop in a ballot box. So basically, it's a system that has the best of both worlds. So here's a quick video on the product, and then we're going to go through it. This is the ballot. This is what's going to be the official ballot. We chose thermal paper stock. It's industrial grade. It's got about a 7-year life shelf life on it before it starts printing colors on you. In Texas, you only need to retain these pieces of paper for 22 months, so it goes well past that retention period. The other reason we chose thermal is because it eliminates all consumables. There's no toner, ink to replace in these devices. They're using thermal printing. So the voter would simply bring their ballot to any device in the polling location to the machine. And these machines are completely independent of each other. You can set them up in all four corners of the polling location. A lot of the machines on the market today have to be chained together. So there's a central brain over here, and it's got a cord going to the first one, a cord going to the next one, next one, next one. Well, if there's a break in that chain somewhere, something fails, and the rest of the polling station goes down. If the brain fails, all voting stops. So we've made them all independent. The linkage between there and there is now just this ballot card being moved physically from one place to the next. So it comes up with the language selection screen. And then voting is just like it normally would be on an electronic device. thing we added to this, as opposed to some of the older systems on the market. The older systems on the market always put one device in the polling location that was ADA compliant. Every device is automatically ADA compliant on these, so that if you have one of them that goes down, you're still compliant with all the ADA regulations. And it works just like a normal ADA machine. They have backup batteries in them. They last about 5 hours on the plug. And then when you plug them back in, the batteries start charging themselves back up. So you go through your ballot, you get to your summary screen. So this is your first chance to review all your selections. You can still go back if you want to change your vote. And on the last screen of the summary screen is a print card button. This is where you would normally see a cast ballot button on an electronic system. So it's putting your selections on that thermal paper. It doesn't record anything in memory. The machine is literally an expensive pencil. But that's one of the advantages of this machine, not restoring or recording any information or data on it, is now the counties can use the devices they're using in early voting on election day. So they don't have to buy as much equipment anymore. Today, if it's recording information on internally, that device has to go in lockdown and can't be used again on election day. So, once the voter has reviewed their selections again, and on this card, and you'll see it in a little bit when you come up and look at it, it's only the selections that they made. It doesn't have the whole ballot on there. And if they did make a selection, it says no selection made. If they decide that they made a mistake, then they would go back to the judge's table and spoil the ballot and be issued a new one.
What if you have a really long ballot on paper, feed multiple sheets?
We don't think you'll ever need multiple sheets. We stress tested the system with a 9-page Miami-Dade ballot. So the 9 pages was a 8.5 by 19 inches long, plus the font. So this ballot page can go up 19 inches as well. And the font size shrinks as well.
He's allowed 58 races, for example, in March.
Yeah, no problem.
Chris, can you talk about the number?
Sure. Oh yeah, and each of the ballots come pre-numbered with serial numbers, just like paper ballots should be numbered.
Does the machine put that number on there?
No, they're pre-numbered when you order them. Yep, so at the check-in table, before they're ever even brought to these machines, you'll see a serial number on them. The voter, after voting, if they're happy with all their selections, they'll bring it over to what we call the DS-200, and it's a digital scanner. So it's scanning an image of the ballot, it's recording the votes to memory, it's taking a picture of the ballot, and then dropping it in the ballot box.
And where does the picture go?
It's on a thumb drive, internally. The reason for the
main brain? Does that go to the main brain now?
Yeah, so at the end of the night, the thumb drive will be taken out of this device and it'll go to the county central tabulation place to be accumulated with the rest of them.
What happens to the paper?
It gets stored.
Just for backup?
Backup or in case of a manual recount. If the paper gets lost or destroyed, the ballot images, that's another purpose of taking a picture of the ballot.
Chris, is there an option for the voter to retain a copy of the ballot in the cast?
No. That would be like a ballot by receipt, and it's not legal. Yes, ma'am.
Because currently on DREs, a recount is really just a recalculation.
Bringing in their electronic copy again. You'll have multiple options with this. You know, if you want to do a manual recount with the paper, you can do that. Or if you want to bring in the results again, you can. Or if you want to print out the images, digital images, you could as well.
Are all four, is that terminal connected to the main brain? The four terminals were connected to the main brain, but is that connected to the main brain?
No, none of them are connected to each other. The only core that's running out of them is the power outlet.
They don't have any wireless capability?
No wireless. The state doesn't certify wireless transmission from any voting devices.
Well, it's good because nothing can go up and nothing can go in either.
Right. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
What generation is the software? As far as, was that built from scratch or was that pulled from a previous generation of one of the machines?
This generation is all ground up, but it's on its third generation of that, so it's gone through about 3 years. The previous generation is not being sold anymore or developed.
Does your firm have a hack group that tries to hack this machine?
No.
And are you aware of any firms that employ that just as a, like a, there are companies who do that to themselves to make sure that they're secure?
Yeah, you know, I don't stay that close with the development activity.
Okay.
But I imagine that, you know, with that DEF CON stuff that's been going on lately, I imagine they've been talking about it quite a bit. It's probably not a bad idea to take those people off the streets and employ them instead of.
So let me make sure I understand this. The ballot, the unique ballot ID. So the entire county of Collin will not have one number that's used in different polling locations. The ballot that I would pick up is the only ballot, Collin County, it's a unique number.
Unique serial.
Okay, so let's say that I spoil my ballot. So then the process would be I'd have to go back to the election judge, get a spoiler report, and give me another one. Same thing, like, okay.
Now that serial number can contain alphanumeric as well. So, you know, multiple polling locations could have a 0001, but there may be alpha letters in front of it too that make a difference. Depending on, because some counties have ordered them, you know, they want every one of their polling locations to be one through whatever, but maybe they put the polling location abbreviation in front of each of them, creating like an alphanumeric serial number. We've had that happen.
All right. What kind of precautions are there to make sure that somebody doesn't pick up a bunch of ballots and walk out with them? I don't know how that would happen.
General polling place securing your polling location like you would today with the electronic devices that activate the ballots in the machines or in paper counties the paper.
Okay, and then my other question is, of course, it's going to be dumping the ballot into that door there, the black box. How many pieces of paper like what you just showed us will stack in one box?
It's probably 3,500 or 4,000, somewhere in there, just depending on how they're going to lay. But I didn't go that deep into this. And this one, we developed another box that they're actually dropping in. So when the ballots are actually falling in a tote bin. So this tote bin will be removed if it fills up and an empty one inserted, so the poll workers never have to put their hands on ballots. They would simply just go to the, pull that off, get all the ballots in it, and then they would lock it up.
What kind of locks do you have on that machine there? Are they the little funky luggage locks?
Barrel keys and then flight locks.
How do you handle provisional ballots?
Okay, so provisional ballots will be checked, you would check them in normally, or depending on what's causing them to be a provisional voter, they would still vote on this device. And the difference is the ballot will have a marking at the top of the barcode, and I don't have one with me. But the ballot will be marked with a barcode that this machine will reject. So they'll still mark their ballot normally, but if they accidentally bring it over here to be tabulated, it'll reject it and tell them to take it back to the poll worker. The poll worker will then put it in the spoiled envelope, the provisional envelope to be brought back and verified.
The other question I have is, since the ballots have unique numbers, is there a way to track that ballot back to that person?
No. No, this machine stores images randomly, and when they fall in that box, there's no guarantee that they're going to fall in the right order.
Wait a minute, if I'm a provisional voter, and I go up and I don't have an ID, so I just sign an affidavit or whatever it is, the poll worker marks my ballot provisional. Mm-hmm. Now, I've got to be checked out later to see if I'm actually provisionally allowed to vote.
Yep.
But if that ballot doesn't have any identifying information about me on it, how do you know that?
If there's someone that was a poll worker, I think they can explain that.
Well, it would still go in the carrier envelope then.
it's part of the.
Now, the information is on the green envelope that goes in, so that's where the information will be. So that ballot will be inside the envelope.
So my name will still be on the envelope.
Your name is on the envelope with all the information, the reason for provisional.
So when you open the provisional ballot to see if it counts it, you're going to know who I voted for.
Yeah, but you do anyway.
That's true.
If you get a mail ballot, I see them too. I forget them as soon as I wipe out.
They don't know now who they vote for because they vote on the machine.
Yeah.
They just, the judge keys in the number?
That's polling location voting, though.
Yeah, it's polling location.
Good point. You haven't memorized all the people and what they voted for in the last
2 years? I have no desire to do so.
So I'm going to continue on the subject of the provisional ballot. The provisional ballot is scanned, a picture is taken of it, and it's dropped into this ballot box, right?
No, not until it's verified by the election staff that it can be scanned.
Okay, so after the provisional voter finishes
after
voting,
they finish marking
the
ballot here, they go back to the poll station to be put in a provisional envelope.
Okay. Hypothetically, say someone does a provisional ballot and drops it in.
Tries to put it over here.
Right.
Yeah, it'll reject it.
So it rejects it. Okay.
And the message will come up on the screen says return it to the poll worker.
I like that.
Yes, sir.
What type of battery is it as far as like lithium?
Lithium ion.
How long was the life on it?
We generally try to replace them every 4 to 5 years, just depending on the amount of elections they've gone through. In Texas, it's probably going to be four or five years tops. So we have elections here.
How much are the batteries? Is it a specific battery built for your company, like a special battery, or is it just kind of a general?
No, it's an off the shelf. It's just soldered on, so it's part of the service contract the county would have with us as far coming out and doing all the preventive maintenance. Once we get to that 4 or 5 year mark, part of the preventive maintenance would be replacing the batteries. I think I've missed him back there a couple times.
When if there's an audit going to take place, this machine's got a thumb drive. That thumb drive goes to the elections, and then someone can test it. So how is the information used now? Take us through that process. Thumb drive goes back. It plugs into the main tabulator.
Okay.
But someone says, hey, we don't like the way it did now. Get the cards, get the thermographic cards, get the ballot, and tell me how they would do it.
So when all the thumb drives are programmed before the election, the software that is used to program them is keeping like an inventory list of all the thumb drives it's creating. At the end of the election, when they all come back and you read them into the reporting system, it's using that same inventory log to know which ones are still left out. If you read them in one by one, if you try to read one in a second time, it'll reject it. And when you get them all in, you've got a list that shows if you're 100% returned or not. As far as if you're not happy with the count, is that what you're?
Right, and then how do you match what the thumb drive says to the thermographic images with their unique numbers?
So when they come back, they're coming back with the tape results. The tape, a results tape will come out of this machine at the end of the night with that thumb drive.
Great.
And so they're going to match it with that. And then along with the poll sign in or the poll book. Yes, sir.
On the provisional ballot, when the person signs the affidavit or whatever the documents you have at the polling location, and then they vote their provisional ballot, and you put that in the envelope, and you, on the outside of that envelope, it has their name, and you, but the envelope is sealed, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So when those provisional ballot envelopes with the ballot inside are delivered to the elections department, doesn't the elections department simply verify whether that person is entitled to vote provisionally or not? And if they are, then you open the ballot, you open the envelope, and then you just go ahead and
scan
the ballot. Mm-hmm. But you don't really know how they voted per se.
Unless you just wanted to sit there and stare at it.
But the envelope, yeah. The envelope is supposed to be separated from the ballot so that the person really doesn't. So the privilege of a vote, a vote is privileged, obviously, secret. So if the person is not eligible to vote in that election, then there's no need to obviously scan their ballot.
Right. Yep, and that'll happen differently depending on the size of the county. A county like Holland would have a high-speed central scanner that it would be loaded on to scan there versus scanned on one of these. Smaller counties may have one of these set aside internally to scan the provision.
So I just want to be clear, Neil actually doesn't know how Jim Pickle votes, is that correct?
I don't really care.
I can't speak for Neil.
Yes, you do.
You're going to vote the same way.
Say, for instance, you have a high-volume voting location, and would you need two or three of these?
It would be a different number depending on what turnout is in that location. I don't know if you noticed, but up front there were probably 7 or 8 machines. This is just what I had in my car. So, I can see in some vote center counties you could have 15 to 20 or more. And it just, the one thing you don't want to happen is a bottleneck, you know, people waiting on a device to vote on. The great thing about this machine, since it doesn't store polling place data on it, during election day or during early voting periods, if you notice one polling location get a lot more turnout than another, you can move these around the county to accommodate the turnout, because they're just marking ballots. Yes, sir.
Chris, on the thumb drives that get returned back to the elections office, what mechanisms are in place to preserve data integrity? In other words, that thumb drive's got data on it. The data can be corrupted due to, you know, electromagnetic interference or whatever. Is there something that happens at the tabulation end that verifies that what's on the thumb drive now is what was on the thumb drive when it came out of this machine?
Yeah, I don't do a very good job of explaining it, but it's part of the encryption process from the time that it gets created to the time it goes out to the machine and when it goes back. There's an encryption process. It takes a digital picture or takes a pic of that encryption code. So if someone tried to mess with it or someone tampered with it, once it comes back, it doesn't match the picture of that encryption, so it would reject it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm.
So what if the device itself fails, the thumb drive?
Uh-huh. Each device has a backup thumb drive in the back of it. Mm-hmm. And if that fails, you can just read. You can bring in a new thumb drive out and re-accumulate the readout of images.
Chris, take one more question.
Just one more? He's a winner.
How many hands are up?
You got a river.
Okay, so I'm running for city council in Murphy, and after all the mail-in ballots are counted, I lose by 2 votes. So since we have countywide polling, I want to recount. And I don't want the pictures. I want the paper ballots. How does that happen?
I'm not sure what process you go through to file for that, right? But I think a district judge has to...
Well, let's say that all that's done.
Yeah.
How are we going to count the paper ballots to verify that I lost by 2 votes?
Someone in here may want to help me with that, because that's where the vendor kind of steps out.
So it would be a ballot board or a team that you pick to do that? And you do it on tally sheets and all that. It's a long, tedious process, obviously, depending on size. If it's a local race, you know, where you have 2,000 votes, it's one thing. If it's a county-wide race, it'll take a long time to recount.
But you could also, you could start by taking them physically and running them all back through
right.
the tabulator.
Right, that's the first thing you do.
And then secondarily, then you could do per.
So in Collin County, they would all be ran, since the high-speed reader would sort, like if you're a district office and you're only in a fifth of the county, high-speed reader could be programmed to separate out all the ballots that don't have you on it.
So you would feed every single paper ballot in Holland?
Yeah, but not through one of these, a high-speed reader.
I understand, but you still take every single paper ballot that was cast during the election of which I'm a part of, and a machine would pull out all the ones that had my race on it.
Okay. And it's $100 a precinct. So those expenses to the county, and that's in statute, $100 per precinct to do a manual recount of what they're talking about.
That's not me charging them.
No, that's the county. That's the county that pays $15 an hour to do what you're saying.
We need 2.6 precincts.
To do a recount. So how many precincts you would have in your...
226.
You'd have to pay $100 times 226.
Yeah, $22,000.
Yeah. At least it is a deposit. Because it won't cost that much, but that's the way it works right now.
Yeah. So And just to expound on that a little bit, on an election that's got people filling in both bubbles, you I mean, that's probably a pretty safe bet, just made 22 grand for a recount because the machines may, you know, they may, the sensors may have gotten dirty or something. But in these devices, they're reading the barcodes, so it's going to be pretty much spot on every time. Like a DRE.
Is there a failure rate?
If there is, I don't know what it does.
He could tell you, but he'd have to kill you.
We put together a video last year, and it's a video that we did for people that administer elections, poll workers, everybody that's involved in elections. So I try to show it to as many people as I can. So once this is over, I promise I'm done.
Short video?
Very short.
For 240 years, forefathers to philosophers have poetically chronicled elections as the cornerstone of our democracy. But who preserves that cornerstone, the undisputed foundation of the country in which we live? This coming election day, 186 million Americans have the opportunity to make their voice heard and their vote equally counted across more than 184,000 precincts in the United States. They will make their way to schools, hospitals, firehouses, community centers, and courthouses. They will exercise a right which millions have fought to obtain, and hundreds of thousands more have paid the ultimate sacrifice to protect. Its caretakers are the more than 80,000 election officials from coast to coast. An outsider thinks Election Day is their busy day every 4 years. And yes, most will work from way before sunrise until way after sunset. But the planning, preparation, and training has been unceasing since the final vote was counted after the last election. This is about an unwavering dedication to make the process efficient yet precisely accurate. A commitment to always maintaining voter confidence. Its stewards are the hundreds of thousands of poll workers, each with their own reason, their own story for why they serve and support. They will set up in the nation's biggest cities, smallest towns, and even on places only accessible by sea or air. Election Day is America's Day, but today we salute all of you. Everyone who works in the shadows to ensure every vote is cast and every vote is counted. Thank you for your passion for the democratic process and understanding its significance to our nation. Thank you for being the cornerstone and the foundation of our democracy. Thank you.